Everybody, there's one more?
I say we get going.
Okay, alright. Good morning, my name is Brian Edgett. I'm a service technician for IPD, Industrial Protection Devices. To avoid any confusion, some of you may know our equipment as BSNB equipment. BSNB as a company owns IPD, they're our parent company, but all of the explosion protection equipment is IPD manufactured and serviced. The equipment, as I said, is explosion protection. I'm hoping many of you are familiar with the hazards of combustible dust and the potential for the issues that can be involved with it. The purpose of our equipment is to protect against that possibility. The equipment that we have is designed to react to a rapid positive change in pressure. That rapid positive change in pressure is monitored for by pressure sensors mounted to the process. The backside of the sensors is directly exposed to the inside of the process. In the event of that rapid positive change in pressure, the pressure sensors will send a signal to all cannons that are associated with that particular zone and actuate all of those cannons at the same time. A system in your application, you have a one cannon system, a two cannon system, a three cannon system, and 2 8 cannon systems. The 8 cannon systems being on the dust collector. The other systems are stretched out along the ductwork involved with the collectors.
So those systems, are any of those in the same chamber but in a different zone of the chamber? And I'm asking because would the release of one of these systems make a positive pressure change that would affect other systems and have a chain reaction? So if one system goes, then they all kind of go.
Typically, that's not the case. The pressure sensors are set to react, in your case, at an actuation pressure of 15 inches of water column. A positive change in pressure of 15 inches of water column. I guess that's not actually true because I've been told that this is a positive pressure system. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it would be a sensor sensing 15 inches of water column.
Delta change.
Not on a positive system. I apologize for stating that earlier. Much of our systems are applied to negative vacuum type systems. So in that case, the pressure sensors reference the process pressure as zero. On a positive pressure system, it's looking for 15 inches of water.
Oh, okay, so as soon as it hits 15 inches, it's going to release.
Correct.
Okay, I got you now.
The pressure sensors do have three individual sensing units. The black box on the table is what we refer to as a sensor. It's a triplex sensor. And as I said, there's three individual sensing units within that box. Two of them are set at the 15 inches of water, and the third one is set at 11 inches of water. So we do have a 4-inch range in there of an alarm status. So in the event of a slower process change or a fluctuating pressure change that doesn't reach the 15 but is above 11, would result in a fault condition. Getting a little bit ahead of myself, the systems do have a fault relay that changes state when there is a fault condition. And FPA says that relay must be connected to initiate a process shutdown. So in the event of a fault, a sensor fault, it should shut your process down if wired correctly.
And that's at 11?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
So at 11, that shuts down our baghouse?
If we get an alarm, it shuts down the baghouse. We go investigate, figure out what's going on, and then we can reset.
And it's just the baghouse, or is it tied to screening in any way,
well,
you know?
The screens interlock to the baghouse, so it'd be the whole thing.
No, the screens are interlocked to the fans. I can run the screen without the baghouse.
Oh.
So they're interlocked to the fans that I run. So if this fails, it should just shut down the baghouse.
Okay.
I'm assuming.
All right, we'll have to investigate that.
Shuts down the fans.
Shuts down the fan system.
Shuts down the whole system, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would assume.
I think it's beyond investigating. If one of these cannons go off, you're not going to be starting it up.
No, he's saying a fault.
No, this is the fault condition.
Yeah,
there is an actuation relay as well that also should initiate a shutdown.
Right.
But
at 11 psi, it registers a fault, shuts down the baghouse, which includes the fans, and therefore our screen.
Well, that we got to find out from Trug. I'm not sure if that's true.
Yeah, okay, maybe not. Much
related to the
no, I know, but I guess I'm confused. You're talking about 15 inches.
Mm-hmm. And 11 inches.
Caused the cannons to go off.
No. 15 inches, correct.
15 inches caused 11. 11
creates an alarm.
Yeah, 11's just a warning.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. So at this point, I'm going to utilize the PowerPoint to give you guys something to look at other than me, and it'll give me a chance to be a little more focused on how I do my presentation. What the training will cover the protection system and the verbiage of what the equipment is. Second section, how to properly perform the quarterly inspection. To touch on that right now, there is a quarterly inspection that is required by the NFPA to be performed. IPD allows the customer to perform it, assuming that there are personnel that are trained. If you would prefer to contract it out, you could either contract an IPD technician to come on site or one of Sonia's crew at Baghouse. There are some people there that are certified that you could contract them as well, which would be my recommendation because they are much, much closer than I am. Third section covers how to arm and disarm the system. And the fourth, how to replace a canister in the event of actuation. This is a very simple drawing of a typical minimal IPD system. The pressure sensor mounted to the side of a dust collector, a suppression cannon, and an isolation cannon. The difference between a suppression and an isolation cannon from an equipment standpoint, they're exactly the same. One cannon for a suppression and a cannon for the isolation are exactly the same, interchangeable. It's just the application that's different. The suppression cannon will put out the deflagration or stop the deflagration as it occurs inside of the process. The isolation cannon simply keeps everything contained inside of that vessel, so we do not have any propagation going through the ductwork or tubing, anything that connects one process to another process or another area. There are a couple of other types of applications that we do. I've mentioned the sensor, the pressure sensor. Another type of protection that we offer is to monitor a rupture panel for an outdoor application and use the opening of the rupture panel to trigger the isolation cannons. The rupture panel would then protect the process, relieve the pressure inside of the process instead of a suppression cannon. Kind of the basic theory of a deflagration and what it is that our system responds to. Basic system operation, the sensor responds to a rise in pressure, three independent detectors or sensors. The logic is two of three, any two of three, sensor one and two, two and three, or one and three, any two of those combinations, or any one of those three combinations will send the actuation signal to the cannons. Detectors are typically calibrated to 10, 6, and 10 inches of water column. Yours is a non-typical for the positive pressure inside of your process. In the event of deflagration, the decision to activate the system cannons is made at the sensor, meaning that a signal does not go from the sensor back to a monitor, and then from the monitor out to the cannons. It's a much shorter travel and allows for a quicker response time.
I have a question on the sensors. Mm-hmm. They're reading continuous, and is there feedback on there? Do we know if we're operating at typically 2 inches or whatever?
They're not a pressure
transducer
monitor.
Okay, they just have a set point and they're calibrated set
right.
point. It's yes or no.
They will point. Yes. Okay. They will tell you if you're below 11 inches, above 11, but below 15 or over 15.
Okay, gotcha.
Is what it tells you.
Okay.
It's not a transducer type sensor.
Okay.
So what are ours calibrated at?
15 inches, 11 inches, and 15 inches. That's also noted on the inside cover of all of the sensors. A pressure wave, in the event of an actuation, pressure wave moves faster than the fireball. So we are responding to the pressure wave, which allows the system to respond fast enough to actually extinguish the fireball in its very, very early stages. There we go. The main four system components, I think we've got them all laid out, almost all of them, laid out on the table. The pressure sensor is the black box. We do not have a system power supply here. Obviously, you have them in your room with the other equipment. The system monitor, which is this device here. It has a monitor board and a power monitor board, a system monitor and a power monitor. We'll go over more further on. And then the red device is the cannon. We have five different sizes of cannons, 5 pound, 10 pound, 20 pounds, 40 pounds, and 60 pound cannons. I believe all of yours are 20 and 40 pound. There's no 5 or 10s?
No.
Okay. The one we've got on the table here is the smallest. It's just the easiest for people to carry around. What the 5 pound and the 10 pound is referring to is the amount of sodium bicarbonate that is in the canister. Sodium bicarbonate is what we use as our extinguishing agent. Sodium bicarbonate is baking soda. It responds with a chemical reaction to the characteristics of the explosion to essentially snuff out the fireball again in its early stages. System power supply. The main purpose of the power supply is to convert the 120 volt AC to 24 volt DC. The enclosure also houses the backup batteries for the system. It also houses the three relays. We talked about the fault relay and the actuation relay. The third relay we've labeled battery. That changes state when AC power is lost and the system goes on to battery backup. A typical application of a cannon mounted to the side of a process. Again, the components are the air tank or nitrogen tank, a disarm mechanism mounted to the barrel of the cannon, the cannon barrel, the junction box, and a air switch. The air switch monitors the pressure inside of the nitrogen tank and will respond with an alarm when low pressure is detected in the nitrogen tank.
Yep.
We've also got a cannon here that we can go over a bit closer following the presentation, and I can give a bit closer description of what is what and how they function.
Is that on low pressure, is that a fault then?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. The typical pressures for the 20 pound cannons is 200 psi plus or minus 10%, so 180 to 220, and that is referencing 70 or 72 degrees Fahrenheit. As your temperature rises, the pressure inside the tank will rise, and the inverse is correct also.
So in your experience, if we have 110 degree weather or something like that, are we going to trigger an alarm?
No. You would have a higher pressure. The air switch monitors for a low pressure condition.
All right.
And keep in mind, we, unfortunately for me, have these systems outdoors in the middle of a field in Fargo, North Dakota in January. So I'm pretty sure you're not going to beat those low temperatures.
No.
And if you start seeing like 30 below zero, then the pressure sometimes drops a bit lower if the pressure was towards the lower end of the scale to begin with.
Okay.
But the air switch will respond when pressure drops below 150 psi, and it clears at 180 psi. There's a 30 psi dead band. system monitor and the power monitor. The top board is the system monitor. The yellow lights that you see, the yellow lights that you see across the top here, the four of them, are the system fault indicators. There's the first one is for a sensor fault, which we explained earlier. If the sensor sees a pressure above 11 inches, and then the three following faults are cannon faults, and I'll go over those once we go a bit further into the cannon itself. Otherwise, they won't mean anything at this point. When there is a fault or an actuation, there are audible alarms associated with each one. One of these white push buttons will mute the fault alarm, and the other one will mute the actuation alarm. The only thing that they do is stop the sound coming from the system. They don't do anything else with the system at all. There is an on and off key switch that's part of the disarm procedure. Green LEDs indicating the overall status, whether the system's armed, whether it's turned on, and whether the system is okay. Also, green indicators tell you that the audible alarms are in their audible position, not muted position. Ideally, what you want to see inside of this box is all and only green LEDs. No red LEDs and no yellow LEDs. Down below is the power monitor. If AC power is lost to the system, this green LED here will change to red, indicating that it is no longer on AC line voltage, but it is now on DC battery backup. There's also an separate associated alarm with that condition that can be muted here, and LEDs below indicating again what the position is of the mute button. There's a DC voltmeter with a push button underneath it. This is part of the quarterly inspection. Pushing the button below the meter will put the batteries on load, and then the meter will indicate what the output of the batteries is under load. Any questions?
What's a Mylar fault?
Mylar fault, the canister. On the process side of it, this would slide into the cannon barrel once the tank is removed, slides in this way, be mounted. This is a stainless steel sheet. In the middle of this disc and the outer perimeter disc, there's a copper path that runs through here. It just monitors the integrity of the face of the canister, make sure that there's not a breach of the face from either being in an incorrect position and having direct contact with an abrasive product, or what I like to call aggressive cleaning practices, where somebody is cleaning a sidewall of something with a metal pole and finds the face of that and shoves the pole through that. While we're talking faults, air fault, we've gone over, the tank pressure drops below. I mentioned what the 20-pound canister, or what the 20-pound cannon pressure is, 200 plus or minus 10%. The 40-pound cannons is 325 PSI plus or minus 10% at 72 degrees Fahrenheit. Circuit fault, inside of the canister, there are electronics with the actuator that the electronics have capacitors on them, and it's not necessarily a voltage signal from the pressure sensor that actuates the cannon or actuates the actuator. It's a signal from the sensor sent to the capacitors telling them to dump their charge to the actuator to fire the cannon. So essentially each cannon has its own self-contained power supply that gets triggered in the event of a signal from the sensor. If those capacitors are continuously charged, if that charge is interrupted for some reason, a circuit fault is indicated. There's a few different ways that signal can be interrupted, the charging interrupted, besides just an actual fault. There's a couple of things that trigger that fault that are normal parts of the operation of the system, such as the disarm procedure. And I'll go over that in the disarm section.
So, uh-huh. As far as this is just a monitor. It sounds like everything that needs to happen is located at each cannon. You said the capacitors are at the cannon themselves?
Capacitors are inside of the canister, yes.
Right, and do the sensors, do they go back to this, or do the sensors get wired to the cannons directly so this doesn't really matter? as far as
this is just an indicator, and it supplies power to the system.
All right.
So the it's a single string. Everything is daisy chained along a single 8-conductor cable. The cable starts at the system power supply, up to the monitor, monitor to sensor, and then sensor to Canon 1, 2, and so on for however many Canons there are. The sensor, when it finds a signal, it sends a signal to the Canons directly mm-hmm. to fire, and then it also sends a signal to the monitor saying, display that I've sent the actuation and that the system is actuated. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, that answers, because I'm just thinking of how good the monitoring system is, and the key in there that says Canon power,
mm-hmm.
that there's really nothing you do in there that can affect these cannons firing off.
There's nothing. Let me explain the event that occurs when the sensor says fire. There's a positive and negative wire that run from the monitor to the sensor, and then a second, those wires are terminated on the circuit board in the sensor, and then next to them is a second pair of wires, positive and negative, that come out of that board and go to Canon 1, 2, 3, so on. When the sensor gets a pressure change that it wants to fire on, it takes the positive and negative that go to the Canons and it reverses the polarity. We refer to that board in the sensor as the reversing board. It reverses the polarity, so a positive voltage up the negative side of the electronics of the cannon or the canister is what tells the cannon to fire. It dumps the charge of the capacitors to the actuator. The actuator actuates, fires, and what that does is, with this inside, the pressure from that ruptures the knife assembly on the nitrogen tank, and I'll pull that apart when we're finished up, has a spring-loaded knife assembly with an X of sharp edges, and a seal contains the nitrogens inside of the tank. There's a hole in the tank about this big. That pressure from the actuator firing pushes that knife assembly up. The edges cut the seal of the nitrogen tank, opening up a hole this big for the 200 or 325 PSI to escape. That then ruptures the canister side, or the process side of the canister. This outer perimeter here, you can think of it as being scored. This central disc maintains its position. The outer perimeter gets torn away, and what you get is a crude cone shape wrapped around that central disc. You get a crude cone shape that acts as a nozzle, and it allows for a dispersion, a blanket of sodium bicarbonate, rather than just one big slug that plops out. It gets sprayed out and a uniform blanket of sodium bicarbonate. So the signal comes from that. The disarm procedure starts at the cannon and ends at the monitor with the key switch. And again, I'll go over that. There's a description, a section on how to go through that. The pressure sensor, these red cups that you see here, there's one here, and one here. Each one of those are the individual sensor or sensing units that I was talking about. This white material between the red cup and the stainless steel body, which appears to be a gasket, is actually a rubber diaphragm. If you wouldn't mind holding that sensor up and just tipping it around or passing it around so people can see what those cups look like. On the back side.
Here you can see what he's talking about. Where it looks like a gasket, it's actually the cup inside.
Those are what are monitoring for the pressure change. In the event of a pressure change, looking at the two on the side, those diaphragms will be pushed outward towards this normally closed, come on, there it is, towards this normally closed switch, this red switch with the white wires connecting to it. there's also a spring assembly. So the diaphragm pushes outward, makes contact with the spring, lifts the spring up, and that spring then opens up the normally closed switch. Two of those switches of the three opening is what sends the actuation signal to the cannons. There are three LEDs on the circuit board. Those are indicator LEDs on whether or not the switches are open or closed. If the LEDs are lit, it means that the switches are in their normally closed position, as they should be. If you have a sensor fault on the system monitor, one of these LEDs should be out. Now, in your case, we have a primary sensor, primary pressure sensor, as well as auxiliary sensors on four of the five systems. There's one system that has one cannon and one sensor only. All of the others have at least one auxiliary sensor. The way that that works is we've just expanded the coverage of the sensing ability of the system. With a single cannon, if this is a cyclone dust collector and you put one sensor right here and you have a deflagration that starts down here, if this is a larger volume process, by the time the pressure wave from this deflagration reaches over here to the pressure sensor, you've allowed enough time for that fireball to grow to a larger, larger size. What we're doing is putting a sensor here and putting another sensor over here so that if something starts anywhere in there, the distance to that pressure sensor has been decreased. The way we do that is we only have one sensor that has the electronics on it, the circuit board, the auxiliary sensors just have a connection point termination strip to add another sensor switch into the series. So the switch here is switch one, the switch here is two, and this one is three. What we do is, you can see we've got a red, white, and blue series of wires here and a red, white, and blue series of wires here. The red wire sends power to switch one. If the switch is closed, we get a return voltage over here. On an auxiliary sensor, we still send voltage out here to switch one, but instead of returning it to the board here, we send this wire over to the auxiliary sensor, run it through switch one on the auxiliary, and then return the voltage back here. So you've got two switches, or three switches, or four switches, depending on how many sensors you have, all returning their signal as open or closed back to the primary sensor. I've talked about two of the three switches opening to activate the system. In the case of an auxiliary sensor, we still need two of the three, but the two of the three cannot be switch one on the primary and switch one on the auxiliary. It has to be a combination of switch one, no matter how many switches there are on the circuit for switch one. It has to be switch one, switch two, or switch three, so that two of these three signals are lost. Does that make sense?
So it can be switch one on this one and switch two on the other auxiliary?
Correct. That's correct. Yep. And on the other auxiliary, you have on your dust collectors or the bag houses, those have eight cannons with four total sensors, one primary, three auxiliaries. So you can have any combination of one and two, two and three, or one and three throughout any of those four pressure sensors.
That air tube right there, is that for calibration?
Mm-hmm. It is for calibration as well as an exhaust port.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's like a breather in case you get pressure, then it's a
static pressure.
Yeah,
on the negative side of the diaphragm.
There's going to be air trapped between the diaphragm and the cup in the event of actuation. We don't want the pressure wave to have to fight against that pressure buildup. It has the tube has check valves. One of them is here, allowing air in this direction, and the other one is hidden down here, allowing air in that direction. So air can escape through both sides of it, but it does not go back in. Okay. There's also a key switch. The key switch switches between test condition and armed condition. Normal condition is armed. That's when everything is normal. Test condition, what that does is it's used for testing. We use it for certification or commissioning of the equipment. What we do is we'll put it into the test condition, ask for process startup, run through any variables involved with your normal running process running, and monitor the sensor. In the test condition, the sensor still monitors and responds as it normally would, but you disconnect power going out to the cannons, so you don't have to worry about the cannons actuating. You can just see what the sensor is doing and how it's responding to any process pressure. Backside of the sensor. And fault explanations.
On the audible alarm,
If
you had to mute it, once the fault's corrected and the system's back on,
it's manual.
You have to go hit it again to
That's
put
correct.
It back in auto.
Yes. Sensor fault occurs when one of the three normally closed sensor switches on the sensor becomes open. It could mean that there's an abnormal pressure condition present, or any of the faults obviously can be created by a damaged wire, a loose wire, or something like that. But that's the true sense of a sensor fault. One of the switches within that zone has become open. Air fault, I've described much of this. Fault will occur when pressure drops below 150 psi for a 5, 10, and 20, and below 250 psi for the 40-pound cannons that you have on site. 200 psi at 72 degrees, plus or minus 10%, and 325 at 72, again, plus or minus 10%. Circuit fault occurs when power to the actuator is interrupted. The disarm mechanism, which I'm going to describe in the disarm procedure section, when a cannon is disarmed, that creates a circuit fault as an indication that, you know, it's in its off condition. Loose or pinched diagnostic wire or a magnet left on the junction box during the quarterly inspection.
What about a power outage?
Power outage,
with any of this?
The batteries take over, assuming the batteries are in their acceptable condition.
Right.
Minimum 20 volts DC is what our specification is. So power goes out, batteries are in decent condition. The system switches over to battery backup without any hiccup whatsoever.
And when power comes back?
it automatically switches changes back over to AC. The only thing that would be manual is if during that power outage, again, there's an alarm that's associated with that. If somebody mutes that alarm, the alarm would need to be unmuted.
Put back to audible.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And what if you, during the power outage, you lose to a certain level of voltage?
If the batteries are put into use and they drain down below what the system deems as acceptable, the first thing that happens is a fault will occur. It's a random fault. Whichever diagnostic circuit is using the most voltage, a fault will occur. The next thing that happens is the system will go into its lockout condition. What that will do is change both the actuation and the fault. Well, the fault would already have been changed because of the random fault, but it will also change the actuation relay to its abnormal condition to shut your process down. The reason for that is so that your process does not run in an unprotected condition.
Well, they're active relays. So once you lose voltage, the active relays are going to turn off because there's nothing powering the relays.
The batteries.
Yeah. Right, the battery goes dead, so the relay is going to become de-energized.
Yes, but at a certain point, there's still enough voltage from the batteries to supply lights to the monitor. You'll have some fault lights going, and then, at some point, the system says, hey, I don't have enough power to do what I'm supposed to. I'm going to shut down. And you'll still have some lights, and then all the lights will come on, and then, depending on how long the batteries are left, then eventually all the lights will go out. Okay? All
right. So on a long power failure, if it's over a day or whatever, and then the batteries die, then the system would shut itself down?
Mm-hmm.
It would fault the whole system?
Yep. Okay. But typically if you have a power outage, your process isn't going to run anyway.
Right.
So
we usually don't have a long one. We have backup generator and stuff anyways. But.
Okay. Mylar fault, I explained that. If you have damage to the face of the canister, that will create a mylar fault. Quarterly inspection. Quarterly inspection is extremely simple, however, it is still important to be performed. NFPA 69 states the owner of the suppression equipment shall perform 3 quarterly inspections. The equipment owner may perform this inspection provided they are trained annually by IPD. IPD offers an annual certification to employees that expires after 1 year. Those employees are able to perform the quarterly inspection, or the inspection may be contracted to either IPD or somebody from back house. A completed copy of the inspection report must be sent to IPD per NFPA requirements.
And so NFPA obviously doesn't call out IPD, but it calls out what, manufacturer?
The manufacturer of the explosion protection equipment.
Gotcha.
Or something to that.
So specifically,
effect.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. This is a copy of the quarterly inspection sheet. It's a little bit difficult to see. I'll go over it briefly now and go over it more in depth with anybody here that's going to be involved in performing the quarterly inspection. We've got, what, 8 employees. I don't know if I recommend necessarily having 8 employees trained. It seems to be a bit overkill to me. I like to see 2 or 3 employees. That way, if somebody is not available or somebody leaves for another job, there's still a backup. But I find that ownership of if you have a smaller group of people, they tend to take better ownership of the equipment and be more involved in it. But I'll certainly train as many people as you'd like to have trained.
So a realistic scenario would be BS&B would come and do an annual,
mm-hmm,
train 2 or 3 on-site quarterly technicians.
Yes.
So each year we would redo the mm-hmm, annual inspection and train again for the next year.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a scenario that we would probably do. Okay.
If you have the same employees that you want to retrain, the retraining is very brief. Like I said, it's an extremely simple. I'm not going to go over all of this whole deal because it's not necessary. 5 to 10 minutes, you tell me how to do the quarterly inspection and I'll sign off that you're still doing it correctly.
So when are we going to be trained for the quarterly, or is that a separate agreement we have to
nope,
do, or is that what we're going
to
do?
No, nope, we can do that when we go over to the equipment. Okay. I was hoping this was a functional system and we could have done it right here, but we'll need to spend a bit of time. For the quarterly inspection, to train out here, will take 10 or 15 minutes.
Okay.
I wouldn't mind doing another 10 or 15 minutes in where the system monitors are to give you an overview of what the system looks like when it's lit up and turned on and everything like that.
Okay.
That is assuming that we are able to turn one of the systems on.
Right.
So, quarterly inspection. All of the systems or zones that we've got, there's 5 zones. Each system is labeled A, B, C, D, or E. That's the IPD system identification or zone identification. And each of the cannons are then labeled with a number, cannon A1, A2. Not only is that an equipment identification for IPD, the cannon 1 and cannon 2 also indicates how the system is wired from the pressure sensor to cannon 1, cannon 2, cannon 3. That greatly helps in any kind of troubleshooting that's needed to be done. All we're looking for with most of our troubleshooting is where does voltage stop? So starting with the last cannon, moving back towards the monitor, cannon 8 to 7, 7 to 6, you'll find where the voltage leads. If you're jumping all over the place, it makes it much more difficult. So keep that in mind. So we'll have system A and cannon 1, cannon 2, cannon 3 on each one of these lines. You can fit as many systems and cannons as you can on one sheet. You don't have to have system B, cannon 1, which there's only one cannon, and then that's it for that sheet. Fit as much of it as you can on a single sheet. If you have equipment identification for your process, or some customers have their own identification for the IPD equipment, each Canon has its own label, Canon or equipment ID 1234. You can include that either here or over on this notes area as well, but we do need to have Canon A1, Canon A2, and so forth. Detonator drain. Earlier I talked about capacitors inside of the canister. We need to make sure that those are able to hold enough of a charge so that there's enough charge there to do what it needs to do when it needs to be done. So what we use is inside of the Canon junction box, there's a circuit board inside of there that has a reed switch. Some of you may be familiar with reed switches, but I'll explain how we use ours and what ours consists of.
The magnet comes into play.
Yep. Basically, there's a tube that's about this long and about that big around. One side of it has two incoming posts. The other has a single post coming in. The single post then has a bar or a filament that comes across and typically will rest in this position on the two leg side of the switch. This is creating a path to charge the capacitors. When you place a magnet, which is included in your equipment, when you place a magnet near that reed switch on the outside of the junction box, you don't need to remove the cover, place it near it, it changes to this position, creating a path here. What this path does is it tells the capacitors to discharge. Now inside the, inside of the junction box on the circuit board, there's five LED lights. Green is normally lit, indicating power. There's also a yellow LED labeled test. When magnet switches the reed switch, discharge occurs. The discharge of the capacitors powers the yellow LED. It'll come on nice and bright, assuming your capacitors are holding a charge. And then slowly as the capacitors discharge, it will become more and more dim until it goes out. All of this can be seen through the sight glass in the junction box. The cover's off, but there's a sight glass in the cover right above the LEDs. What we need to know is how many seconds it takes for that LED to go out. Typically, unless you've got a light shining right on your box, typically you're going to see about anywhere from 10 to 13 or 14 seconds. The darker it is, the longer you're going to be able to see the yellow LED. Minimum drain time is 5 seconds, meaning minimum time the light can be lit. It must be lit more than 5 seconds. We would like to see how many seconds you see it as being lit, not yes, check, pass, okay, meaning it's over 5 seconds. Actually put down what the time is. What that will do is potentially allow us to see a trend that's developing with a decreasing amount of time. So pretty simple to do. Tank pressure. You have a maintenance kit. That has something very similar to this. Basically, you make sure that your air gauge is closed. Don't leave it open because you're going to dump out a bunch of nitrogen and that gets annoying. So make sure that that's closed. Remove the cover from the Schrader valve on the nitrogen tank. Screw this on. See what's being shown on your gauge. Remove, relatively quick remove, relatively quick put on to limit the amount of nitrogen that escapes. Probably not more than 1 or 2 PSI at a time. And then remember to put the cap back on to keep any type of debris from getting into the Schrader valve and causing leakage. Put the cap back on, and that pressure gets recorded right here. Down below here, it tells you 5, 10, and 20-pound cannons, 200 PSI, 40 and 60, 325 PSI. Tank temperature. Like to indicate what the ambient room temperature is of the nitrogen tank. That gives us an idea of how much pressure we should be seeing. If you're 110 degrees or if you're 60 degrees, you'll see maybe a 10 PSI difference in what the specification should be. Page 6 of the manual has a chart showing what pressure you should expect to see at what temperature. It's a linear graph. You find what the pressure is, or the temperature is, go up to the line, cross-reference to the pressure that is associated with that temperature. Battery load test. Earlier we saw a picture of the system monitor. Come on. Oh, I think I broke it. So for the rest of the time, we'll have a rear view of the sensor. I'll give it a couple of minutes.
There you go.
All right.
Did you need to refer to anything in this? I've got my copy.
If you want to find, yeah, right there.
Okay. If anybody needs copies of these, I can print more copies of the manuals too.
Yeah, there were 5 hard copy manuals that were shipped with the equipment, and 1 soft copy like that. That was included with the system manual or the system maintenance kit. So you should have 6 copies of that. Can also easily supply digital copies if you would like. But the battery load test, as I showed, I don't have my arrow any longer. The bottom board below the meter has the button to be pushed, which there it is. Yeah. The white button that says battery load test with the arrow pointing to it, thank you. That button gets pushed. What'll happen is if your batteries are not in the best condition, you'll see that meter, if it's normal, it normally will show what the voltage being sent to the system is, roughly 24 volts. Once you push that button, that meter will hiccup a little bit and go back up, and if your batteries are not that good, at that point it'll start just going like this as the batteries are showing they're weak under load. So what I recommend is holding that button for however long it takes for the meter to either stabilize, meaning it stops where you can easily see it moving, it stops to where you can't see it moving, or whether either that or if the meter drops below 20 volts. I personally don't care if the batteries show 19.9 or 9.9 volts. Anything below 20, it needs to be replaced. So, or the batteries need to be replaced. Okay? Let's see if going slower will help.
No, they're going too fast.
No. Okay. That only needs to be written once. Where it says battery load test, there we go, only once per zone or system. Something else to point out, the 2 dust collectors or bag houses they each have a single system monitor like this one here. The other 3 zones across the ductwork have what we call a triple monitor. It has a box that instead of being like this, is going to be like this, and you have 1, 2, 3 of these boards inside of it, and they all share a single power supply. Everything else is the same, other than you've got 3 that say that share the power supply. So in this case, you would only need 3 battery load tests because you've only got 3 sets of batteries. Disarm mechanism test. On the Canon, excuse me, if you can see it, we've got a disarm mechanism. It's this device here. That's part of the disarm procedure. What that involves is this disc rotates 180 degrees and stops. 180 degrees and stops. There's also a flat side to it. The flat side will reveal either the word off or the word on and indicate whether the disarm is in the disarm or the non-disarm position. In the disarm or off position, it will trigger a circuit fault because it's interrupting power to the canisters. There's also, Which position? Is the flat side down or up?
It's down.
It's down? Okay. There's also supposed to be a pin, a metal pin, that sticks in there. This one, through transportation, traveling all over, it's become damaged. But that pin, when the disarm disc is rotated around, there's a channel that's cut into that disc. So when it's rotated into the off position, you get something like this that allows for a lock to be put on over that pin and utilize a lockout tagout procedure if that's something that you've decided to do in your procedure. So basically, you don't need to see the word off or the word on. Obviously, if there's a circuit fault, something isn't correct if you've rotated them. But just looking at it, you should be able, if you can see whether that disc is up against the pin or the flat side is up against the pin. If the flat side's there, a lock's not going to stick on that pin. It's going to just slide on and off, obviously. If it's rotated around, you can tell it's off or in its on position just visually. For the quarterly inspection, what we want to do is to have you rotate that disc from its off on position to the off position. Verify through the sight glass in the junction box that you have a red LED, circuit fault LED, that is indicated, and then rotate it back to the on position. Verify that the light goes out. On the disarm or on the quarterly inspection, indicate either yes or no here. Next column is cannon size. We need to know whether 220 PSI is acceptable for a 20-pound cannon or whether it's low for a 40-pound cannon. So indicate what cannon size it is that you've got. That tells us what pressure we should expect to see. My recommendation is that I email a digital copy of this to somebody here who's going to be in charge, maintenance supervisor, something like that, and that they, it's just an Excel spreadsheet document. I recommend you type in inland, city, state, and type in zone A, cannon 1, cannon 2, cannon 3. Type in all the redundant information, including the cannon sizes, and save that document. And then when it's time for quarterly inspection, you print that out and you're not continuously typing your company name and all of that other thing and then having to know which cannon sizes for which one, because the cannon sizes are not going to change.
They're not labeled?
They are labeled. The standoff on the side indicates what cannon size it is, and it also indicates what the pressure is for that cannon. The standoff on the top has a plate on it as well. Don't look to that for information. That's just a certification for that pressure vessel. Even though it's a real small little tank, it is still a pressure tank in the eyes of whatever governing body that is that monitors pressure vessels. So there's not any information pertinent to IPD on that. Everything will be on the side standoff. Any questions at this point on the quarterly inspection? I know I've given you a lot of theoretical things to do. We will go over and do a quarterly inspection on one of the cannons, show you how it's done and how it works. But anything in a quiet environment anybody wants to ask?
I noticed on you have on all the circuit boards you have a switch that looks like a key switch. Is that just for people that will come in and do some type of repair work?
On the cannons, the key switch, what that does...
On here, and then on your sensors, and then even on your board, it seems like there's a little arming switch.
There's a key on the circuit board for the cannon. There's a key on the pressure sensor, which we talked about being the test and armed toggle. And there's a key on the system monitor as well. I actually kind of stopped on my description of the disarm procedure, so I'll remind me to go back onto that. The key on the cannon is only used by IPD. What that does is it toggles between having the canister be online or part of the system versus what we call a dummy plug. The circuit board has a plug port that we plug these, basically a fake canister, just a little electronic device, and it tricks the system into thinking that the system is actually armed with the canisters. but in fact, it's the canisters are all offline, and we use that for testing. We don't supply those to anybody other than IPD technicians, so therefore there should be there's no reason for anybody to use that key switch. But just explaining what it is. Back to the disarm procedure. Rotating the disarm to the off position creates a circuit fault. If the noise created by the alarm on the system monitor is going to bother anybody, the first step would be to mute those alarms, those white push buttons that are in here. Push those are just momentary switches. Off, on, off, on. If the noise is gonna bother anybody, I recommend just pushing both of them. So do that. Then on each cannon associated with the system or zone that you want to shut off, go to each cannon and rotate the disarm mechanism to the off position. Through the sight glass in the junction box cover, verify that you have a red circuit fault indicated. That's your visual indication that the disarm mechanism is functioning correctly. If you don't have a red circuit fault, it's not functioning, investigate why it's not functioning. Do that on all of the cannons associated with the zone that you're disarming. Apply your lockout tagout if it's part of your procedure. Return to the system monitor. That's normal on position. At that point, turn the system off. That's the recommended disarm procedure for the system. Okay? The sequence to disarm is specific. You need to leave the key on, rotate the disarms, and then turn the key off. Reason for that is if you turn the key off first, you're disconnecting power to the cannons. You're not going to have your red verification that your disarm is working correctly. So, mute the alarms, rotate your disarms, then turn the key off. To rearm the system, the sequence doesn't matter. You can turn the key on first and then rotate, or rotate first and then turn the key. Either way, it doesn't matter.
The challenge I have is, if you're gonna get lights on your monitor system when you go through this quarterly, then how do you, or how do you suggest us not turning our system off if I'm going around doing quarterlies and we have the fans are running and I switch this knob and I'm checking for to see if the system and fault lights are having, won't me getting a fault light close our system down because it's wired into that?
Yes. So therefore, quarterly inspections and annual certification, the process must be down to perform. So you'll have to find
So what you're saying is, we could bypass it, but the problem is when you're providing your inspections, since we're testing these, we'll have no fire suppression if something happens during this quarterly test.
Correct. You're compromising the system when you're performing these tests, particularly the detonator drain, the magnet test.
Okay.
That's disabling that cannon. Once you drop the magnet and activate that reed switch, your cannon is disabled.
Okay.
So it must be, it's recommended strongly that you do it that way. If by chance OSHA or somebody sees you disabling part of a system while your process is running, there could be repercussions for that.
And this, I noticed when you said the switch turns off power.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, when it's in the disarm, do the contacts become dead then as far as external alarm system?
The fault relay will be actuated with turning the system off. The actuation relay is not tripped.
Okay, so as soon as you turn that key, it's going to provide a fault to the system.
Correct. Okay. Yep, you're disconnecting power, basically disconnecting power outside of this box.
Mm-hmm.
Up on top here is where the field wiring connects to. It goes directly from here to the sensor and so on. You're disconnecting power to there, therefore you're disconnecting your outgoing diagnostic check. You don't have any return voltage. It sees that as a fault. Okay. Again, when you rotate the disarm, you do have a circuit fault, so forgetting to rotate one of the cannons in the zone, you'll still have a fault showing, telling you that something's not right. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Any questions on the quarterly inspection at this point? Once you access the cannon, once the cannon is in front of you, it should take you no more than 2 minutes maximum to perform the quarterly inspection. Magnet test takes, you know, let's say 30 seconds if you do it twice because you slipped on your magnet placement. And then checking the nitrogen takes 30 seconds as well, or 45 seconds. So it is a very simple procedure.
If you're out in the field and you turn the, as you said, you turn the knob, mm-hmm. and you look at the power, and then you say, then you go over to the box to silence it and turn the key to fault. That means then you, after you turn it back on, I'm trying to see how many times I'm going to have to go back and forth per cannon. If I have all these cannons, can I just leave the key active and do all my cannons at one time? Instead of going back and forth of turning it off and turning it on, then coming back, rotating the switch, moving to my next cannon.
Okay, I think maybe you misunderstood or I didn't explain well enough. If we're going to disarm this one cannon system, or let's make it a two cannon system with a second theoretical cannon, the first thing I want to do is, do you know where the monitors are?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know how often people are in that room, but if the alarm sounding in there is going to bother anybody, step one is to open the box and push the mute buttons.
Okay, so the mute buttons can be used without an alarm happening, you're saying?
Sure.
They're not a momentary silence. I'm actually turning it off.
It's a switch to either activate the horn. These are the alarms.
No, I see. So if I push the mute button, does that give me a light in there that I've just muted something?
Yep. Yeah. You've got green is audible, yellow is muted for each individual switch. Okay. So step one, mute the alarms. Step two, go to the first cannon, rotate the disarm mechanism, verify through the sight glass that you have a red LED lit, circuit fault lit. Mm-hmm. Move to the second cannon, rotate, do that on all of your cannons associated with that zone, and at that point you return to the monitor and turn your key off. So you twice, assuming you're going to mute the alarms, you have to go to the box twice, once at the beginning of the disarm and once at the end of the disarm. To rearm it, I think it's basically the same thing, or if you prefer to do the cannons, rotate all the cannons first, and then return to the box, then you're only returning once. You turn the key on and unmute the alarms at that point.
I guess what I'm trying to understand, is that just part of resetting why you have to turn the key off and on? Why don't you just leave the key on, and then after everything, shouldn't everything just go back to the way it was? I'm trying to understand why you need to turn the key.
Because then your components are still energized. This de-energizes all the components. The disarm mechanism is what I call a redundant safety lockout device. It allows for a lockout tagout at that component, and it gives a backup for any transient voltage, static discharge, something like that. An analogy I use is a parking brake on an automatic transmission vehicle. If you put your car in park, you're probably not going to roll anywhere. That's this switch here. Turning this off, you're probably not going to have any problems with the cannons. But your emergency brake, all the auto manufacturers still supply an emergency brake. That's what the disarm mechanism is. That rotates, it basically shorts out the electronics, cutting off the possibility of any stray or static voltage getting past or into the system past this, and affecting that canister directly, that cannon directly.
I guess I understand what we're doing here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand after you test all the cannons, because you left the switch on so voltage would be supplied to the circuit.
Are we testing or are we disarming? Those are two different things.
Well, I think you're doing two different things here. You're saying I'm doing a quarterly test.
Well, that, quarterly inspection.
Inspection.
That was this here. That key switch stays on all the time.
That was Randy's question.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood.
I understand, because you confused me when you were talking about inspection and then you moved to disarm.
I apologize.
Because during the inspection, we're not disarming anything.
You're rotating the disarm off and then right back on
Just look at the little red thing.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with that key switch. Though.
Correct. The key switch stays on all the time. All
right. And so when I want to disarm the box, then I turn that key.
Yeah, the disarm procedure is what I went over with rotating all of the cannons, applying a lock, and turning it off. I'm sorry if I ran it together.
In a quarterly inspection, we go to the panel, we do the stuff, and then we go through all of the systems, and then we go out into the field, and we go all the systems. And we don't have to go back and forth for each system. Right, okay.
No, you can just do sure. Whatever it is that fills up that sheet the most effectively or productively.
Beautiful.
Yep.
Okay.
I get this question, another question. Why would I ever disarm that?
Anytime you create a hole, open a door, anytime you access any part of the area with an explosion protection system on it, you want to disarm the system.
So like
changing filters. One
great
door,
example.
Shut the system down to take one door off just to look inside.
So that's two things: is disarming the cannon by turning it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then disarming that is just a secondary, say, because we're stopping voltage from going out to the cannon.
It's all part of the recommended disarm procedure.
Okay, so that's the power knife, and then that's the physical barrier.
Mm-hmm. It's a backup, a redundant
backup. Okay.
Safety device. If lockout,
physical barrier, it's just a disconnect.
Yep. Okay. If lockout tagout's part of your procedure, I don't recommend removing the key and using the key in your lockbox. Leave the key inside and apply a lock. These are little knockouts. I think they're knocked out on yours, but you can put a lock in there, which keeps the box from being able to be open. That's where I recommend putting the lockout device.
Is there a knife that cuts power to those that we can put our lock on? Like one thing that cuts power to that
battery
thing?
Backup.
Oh, yeah, okay. All right.
Yep.
Okay.
So any more questions on either the quarterly inspection or the disarm procedure? Okay, again, we're going to go out to the equipment. The equipment's going to be turned on. It's going to be armed as you're normally going to see it. So we'll be able to show you, and you'll see an exact example. Yes?
Does the auger lids apply?
The thing is, the positive pressure in your process changes things slightly, but I would make it the practice and the procedure that if you open anything on that process, that you disarm the system. Make sure your process is shut down and disarm the IPD equipment.
Okay.
That's our recommendation. The sensors are not intelligent enough to know the difference between pressure from a deflagration versus pressure from fingers, air hoses, pressure washers, elbows, anything like that.
How often do we have false alarms in these things in reality? Not false alarms, false detonation or whatever.
Unwanted actuation?
Yeah.
It depends on how well your pressure, process pressure is regulated.
Understood, but in the real world, how often does that happen? I mean, do you get
a few.
Okay, a few a year or a few ever?
I would say of the thousands of systems that we have, maybe a few a year. And typically those are, the main reasons for those are typically operators just ramping up a process. I blame third shift all the time. They ramp up their third shift process. There's not supervisors around monitoring, and they create product issues with plugging or backflow, things like that. The other issue, again, is any type of plugging with a process that, you know, creates either an over-positive pressure or an overly negative pressure that then releases towards positive. You think of having a typical dust collector running negatively. You put a plug on that, your process pressure continues to ramp up, and then that slug releases and it changes.
All right, that's good to hear. So it's pretty rare. Mm-hmm. And then when that happens, what's the overall impact? It's not much, right? It just kind of goes into the dust system and you recharge everything and you go back to work?
Your process, is where these systems are, is that reusable product for anything that contamination would be a problem? Then it's refitting the cannons.
Okay. All right. So it's not too devastating if that happens then.
Do we know if
you got a little base to your
possible with our fan system if I can overload our system?
He might be down.
I don't think so, but I don't know.
Because usually we typically don't run all the fans on this system. If I, some reason, shift three, you know, like you're saying, somebody decided to open up all the fans and crank them on.
What's your gut on that? Let's just say we typically run 60% of our fans. If we ran to 100% of our fans, are we going to come up to 11 pounds?
Well, the thing is you never...
11 inches?
You're looking at... We just go out there with a manometer and find out. I mean, I never see it go over 2.5 inches differential across the backup.
You ran a test before you did this. You ran tests on it, right?
Yeah, I'd have to check with Steve. See what Steve was testing. Steve had testing data when we came out and did it.
And I would imagine you tested the full.
I'd have to see how many 100%. Fans they had.
Well, maybe today while we're out in the field, we'll play around with that.
Yeah, and keep in mind, differential pressure is different from static pressure that the sensors are looking for.
Right, but I can't see it being that high.
I can't even see it very close. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Good.
Okay.
But the thing is to put a manometer on it and find out, or whatever your readings are.
You said typically it's 10, 5, and 10?
10, 6, and 10.
10, 6, and 10.
Yep.
What was the difference for ours to 15. Go?
Because you're on a positive pressure system.
Okay.
Yep.
Now, in case the canister goes off, is that something that you guys have to come in and repair it, or we just...
No, you can certainly repair it. It's relatively easy. The quick rundown, very quick rundown, you remove the four bolts. We don't have the finger nuts on our tanks. We actually have, you know, bolts or nuts on there. Remove the four nuts. Remove the nitrogen tank. This canister is going to be blown out. Remove the spent canister. The disarm mechanism needs to be removed as well, because there's a piece that goes like this that you can't remove it. So that needs to be removed. The six conductor wire needs to be removed. The new canister gets installed. The wire gets run through the wall into the junction box and terminated. The nitrogen tank has 8 bolts involved with the refit. There's a round metal seal and a rubber gasket. So you remove the 8 bolts, you remove a ring, the seal and gasket, put the new seal and gasket on, put the ring back on, put the 8 bolts back in, torque them, and tight is not a torque spec, torque them, and install the nitrogen tank, charge the nitrogen tank, and that's roughly it. I know I've greatly simplified the procedure, but once you reach a cannon, it should typically take, depending on how difficult it is to remove the spent cannon. Some of them come out relatively easy. If you do have an actuation, I recommend you're legally should not anyway, but I recommend not running your process until you remove the canisters. What happens then is it gets packed in with all of your product, and many times you need to remove the barrel and knock it out from the inside. It can't be removed. So, depending on how easy it is or difficult it is to remove the spent canister, 45 minutes to an hour and 15 minutes to completely refit a cannon for the first one. The second one would be closer to 45 minutes.
And there's different sizes?
Two different sizes, yep.
So with the, and I imagine this is a shelf item then, so we call up and within 24-hour shipping it will appear on our doorstep.
I believe you have these on site.
You guys have spare canisters.
Oh, we do?
Yes.
So we have canisters and the kit to repair that.
Yep.
Okay.
It all comes in one box. It's the box says canister with refit kit.
Okay.
So everything is in a single box.
Does it expire?
No.
Never expires.
If you do need canisters, either for a failure or an actuation, I highly recommend having the replacements on site. Keep in mind that it is a hazardous goods to ship, so it's very specific on who can ship it, how it can get shipped. And 2 years ago or something, Christmas was on a Tuesday, I had a customer call me on Saturday morning at 9 a.m. saying they had an actuation and needed canister refits. You got Sunday, no. Monday's Christmas Eve, Tuesday's Christmas Day. We were able to work something out for them, but potentially it could have been 5 days before they had it on their doorstep. So something to keep in mind, that worst case scenario, you may not be able to get something next day.
How much are those things?
The 20-pound cannon, which is the smaller 2200,
For I that think. Little, that thing?
This one, the 5 pound is like 1600, well, I think.
Dan, you don't keep those in stock, do
No.
How much you got?
Okay.
It's expensive bacon soda.
How much are the filters?
In case they have a case like that.
How much are the filters?
Okay.
The option is to hire a private plane.
With that,
I had to do that for a customer one time, and then I had to buy a last minute airplane ticket because I can't carry passengers. Legally, they can't carry passengers. So $3,000 is the plane, I think, on top of the cost.
And Jeff, part of the kits that you guys bought, the spare parts and all that stuff, I'll give you the actual number of how many canisters you have for each can, for each size cannon, because you have so many of each out there.
Yeah, you've got five zones. You don't need to keep a cannon or a canister for each cannon out there. What you want is a quantity that will allow you to refit any one of them that fires at a time at any time. So. Tools needed for the quarterly inspection, I've gone over it. I showed you the 1 foot air gauge hose that I have. The magnet is just a small, excuse me.
And that's our kit?
No, this is my toolbox.
That's his, but yeah, you do have a
black
or red.
We have a kit with a magnet
and
a thermometer
box.
And all that?
Yes.
Okay.
Magnet, just a simple, mine's pretty dirty, yours has a nice clean new sticker on it. But basically just a normal magnet and a thermometer. The maintenance kit does come with a digital thermometer. I say that it's optional. If you can roughly guess what the temperature is within about 10 degrees, okay, you're fine. The difference between 70 degrees and 60 degrees or 70 and 80 on our chart is maybe 1 PSI. So if it's 70 and you put down that it's 40, or if it's 100 and you put down that it's 70, then you're talking 5 plus PSI, something like that, and it's a little more significant. So the kit does contain a digital thermometer. Feel free to use it. Otherwise, you know, be very close.
Okay.
Okay?
I have a quick question on the discharge. If one of them discharges in a system of like four,
mm-hmm,
well, they all discharge,
problem,
right?
They're
all going to sync together, right?
They should all.
Yeah.
The signal from the sensor goes to all of the cannons.
Right.
If you have a single one, there's something that has gone wrong.
If one just fires, there's something wrong with that one.
Yes. Okay. Unless it's the yes.
Right.
Yep.
But otherwise,
assuming it's not the single cannon system.
An area where one fires, they're all firing.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
All right.
I think I've gone over the capacitor drain, the magnet test, nitrogen tank pressure. I've gone over all of that information. Battery load test as well. Disarm mechanism test, end of inspection, unmute all of the alarms, verify all and only green LEDs are lit in the monitor, comments area of the form, note any information that may be useful. Something I didn't mention, if you check the nitrogen pressure on one of the cannons and it's supposed to be minimum 180 and it shows 165 or 170, please still write 165 or 170 in the pressure, and then over in the notes area, filled to 200 or 220. Again, as I said, plus or minus 10%. If you need to fill a tank, fill it to the plus 10%. It gives you that much more of a window before you'll need to top it off again. The tanks are similar to your car tires, if not sealed a bit better. You know, even if it's perfect, you still will lose some pressure over time. I'd say you should be able to get a year to 2 years before you need to top it off, assuming they're topped off to the top 10%.
Do these tanks ever need to be certified or recertified?
No. Well, I guess there's an annual certification.
It's a pressure vessel, so I'm thinking you're filling a pressure vessel. You know, all of our pressure vessels, even our air tanks, are certified.
I guess that would depend on what your local requirements are. So that might be something that you need to check out with your local authorities.
Because these aren't stamped, are they?
On the top.
On the top.
Yeah,
okay.
The top.
Yep.
Okay. Did you already ask a question?
That's a good question. I don't know that I've ever had that question asked.
He doesn't. He says check with local authorities.
Okay.
Hey, you brought up something about this. Do you know anything about the housekeeping itself? For there, are we going to have something on site, not for the system, but just housekeeping, how often we housekeep? Is that part of these new rules?
Do you know?
I believe that the recommendation is, or the guideline is anything over the thickness of a paper clip is unacceptable housekeeping as far as product building.
So there's no, but how about record keeping for housekeeping, or is it just housekeeping?
That's outside
period?
Of,
okay.
That's
I'm just
outside
asking.
Of me. Yep.
No, I'm just yep. seeing if you know of any record keeping.
That's the only one I know of that anything over, whatever the thickness, there's an actual number, but I don't remember what it is.
Okay.
But anything over the thickness of a paper clip is potentially hazardous. So.
Okay.
Excuse me, 16th of an inch desktop.
Yeah.
Once you're done with the quarterly inspection, it will be emailed to IPD. We prefer email. It does, you can mail it. We used to have a fax number as well, but I took the fax number off. The reason for me strongly recommending the email is that if you send me the report, and I see, oh, you know, you have a note on this is something that needs attention, or you have a pressure that's not right, or something I need to comment to, I can hit reply. You send me a fax, you know, I've got a name on there, but I have no real way of contacting somebody. And there's many maintenance people that don't have an email address or a phone number, so it makes it much more difficult. Hitting reply gives me a very quick response back to the person who sent it to me. And the email address is on the form. Make sure that everything is filled out and that it is signed. Arming and disarming. Pretty much went over all of this, unless somebody would like me to go through it again that it wasn't clear.
If you're going to work on a pressure switch, or are you saying we're not allowed to work on a pressure switch?
The pressure sensor?
Yes.
The only maintenance item that we don't allow is for calibrating the sensor.
Okay.
That only that performance can be done by IPD. Everything else, including replacing the sensor, replacing the circuit board in the sensor, everything else can be done by the customer if they choose.
Okay. Because I'm thinking if you have, like you said, three of these sensors, you have the master with the circuit board, and you have like three remotes. One. All of a sudden it says, one of your sensors is bad. Well, when you have three of them, then you're going to have to go out and test each one by itself and see which
correct.
One has closed.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're going to do that, then I imagine all the cannons have to be put, of course, in an unarmed state. You're monitoring an unarmed state because you don't want to trigger any of this stuff.
Uh-huh. At that point, what I would probably recommend if you called me looking for assistance and I asked you to do that, would be to turn the system off.
Right, let everything drain down, and then find the bad sensor.
Correct, yep.
Pull it out. Okay, but once you do that is, then the thing is you're considering the system offline now, with that sensor missing.
Or it's
a bad sensor.
Uh-huh.
And can you operate with a bad sensor while you're waiting for a new one?
It would depend on the condition.
Because you said they're there for a reason. You have three remotes. So three of them are working, but you're saying out of the nine, only eight are working.
No, that's a good question. And it would depend on what the problem with the sensor was.
Okay.
With the auxiliary sensors, the only problem you could have with them is that one of the switches either is become damaged where it's not opening and closing, or in this case particularly closing correctly into its normal close, or if there's something actually wrong with that sensor. What I would probably recommend is that I would, if we know what the problem is, say it's a bad switch, what I would recommend is that we send out a new sensor to you, and you swap it out at the first opportunity after you receive the new one. One of the reasons that I'm comfortable with that is that you have three switches. One of them is redundant. And so losing one of them for a short period of time, a day or two, you're still okay.
Okay.
The other option is to have a primary and an auxiliary on the shelf. The sensors are a consumable item. It's typically minimum 2 years, maximum. I've worked on some sensors that are 12, 13 years old and are still able to be calibrated.
You said calibrated, and that concerns me. Is we went over checking the system stuff. I must have missed, when do you test or calibrate the sensors to make sure they're still at 11 or 15
inches.
That's
an annual certification when we come on site. Quarterlies are done by the customer, if chosen, three times. The fourth time, on the annual basis, we come in, and typically the quarterly inspection is part of what we do since we're at the cannons anyway.
So you do that, and then that's when you say, I can retrain you for the next year, because you're out here annually anyways.
Yep. Exactly.
And if people move around or change, then he can train even brand new people.
Yep. Make sense?
Yep.
Good deal. I think we're getting towards the end here. Disarming, we've gone over. I went over this, but here's a picture of it. A cannon that has been partially disassembled. The disarm mechanism has been removed. The canister is not a spent canister, but it's been removed. You can see the inside of the nitrogen tank here, the springs, and the seal, as well as the Schrader valve. So this gives you an idea of what's involved in the insides of the canister, or the cannon. While we're looking at this, I will give one of my two very strong, it would be a requirement if you worked for me, but you don't, so it has to be a strong recommendation from the manufacturer. Never remove a nitrogen tank while it's charged. That might seem obvious to some people, but my experience says that it's not obvious to everybody. Always discharge the canister before the nitrogen tank before removing it. The seal that I was talking about, the disc right in here, is actually two pieces of metal. One of them is 3/1 of an inch, and one of them is 4/1 of an inch thick. So you have that amount of metal containing 220 PSI or 340 PSI. The sharp edges of the knife are maybe that far away from the face of that seal. Removing it, as easy as it may seem, if you remove it and accidentally go like that, it's going to be trouble. And the tanks are heavy enough that removing them from a side position is not necessarily the best practice for doing it ergonomically. Getting in front of it and pulling it towards you is the best. So, strong recommendation, or even stronger recommendation to anybody here that might be able to make it a requirement.
No, it's required. I mean, there's no question. That would be very unsafe. So.
Yes.
Yeah.
So,
we'll discharge it.
That's number one. Number two, while we're on the subject, the canisters. And keep in mind, this is not a real canister. There's nothing inside of it. But the canisters, when they come from the factory, have four of the six wires that are soldered together. These four wires are soldered together. What that does is it shorts out the wiring, shorts out the electronics, keeps it safe from anything being introduced to it that shouldn't be there, static electricity or something like that. Anytime you can see the canister, whether it's the face of the canister after removing a drained nitrogen tank, or off the shelf while you're installing it, anytime you can physically see the canister, these wires should be either soldered from the factory or tied together in some way. If we have an electronic failure with a canister and it needs to be replaced, keep in mind an actuated canister is totally different. It's done. There's nothing that can happen to that one. That's fine. But if it's not actuated and you need to replace it or remove it, before you remove the nitrogen tank, take these wires, strip back a good 1.5 to 2 inches of wire, strip the insulation off, twist them together, and then proceed as normal. Put a more permanent solution on there once you've got it out and in your shop, whether it's solder.
Describe what would happen if we failed to do that and there was the right amount of static electricity, et cetera. What does that thing do?
Number one, you've just used up your luck or unluckiness, but you're not going to win the lottery because I've never seen it happen, but there is the potential for it to happen. I've never seen or heard of it happening.
Describe it.
Actuating the canister, causing it to blow up. So once these are soldered or twisted or tied together, everything is fine. Or more fine than the point something 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 chance that something wouldn't be.
But if that's away from the nitrogen, what does blowing up look like? Just curious. I mean, what is? There's no nitrogen there to do anything. What would happen?
It would blow up. I don't know how else to describe it.
Okay. All right.
It's not something. Yeah. So you'd have.
Gotcha.
Powder going off both sides, or more particularly out so this side. This is the weaker side, intended to be the weaker side than this side.
Neighbors.
So.
Yeah.
Those are the two my two safety strong requirements.
Yeah.
And that was while we were on this slide showing the nitrogen tank. Canister replacement. I think I've gone over that, and going into detail, I don't feel as productive because number one, all goes well, this won't need to be done for a long, long time. And at that point, I'm saying call us anyhow.
Yeah.
Don't just say, hey, I had training a year or 2 years ago. No, call us. We'll either give you this again and we'll walk you through the specifics for doing the replacement.
Well, we have BSB on contract to come out and do the annual and provide, you know, if we have an issue, we'll call them out.
That's up to you. Yep. Okay.
I don't know if this is still embedded.
Who what? Wayne.
I used to have a video. If you guys have time and are interested, I've got a short video of some of our testing of both the equipment and explosions. It's maybe 4 or 5 minutes.
Yeah, that'd be good.
I would need to have Vicky load it back up.
When you load it back up,
it's on a flash drive.
Oh, all right.
Somewhere in this.
Yeah,
pocket.
We can do it. Just throw it to Greg. We can get it on there.
Okay.
Here.
I'll go with you to just.
8 systems, 22 cannons. Is that how it works?
No, you have 5 systems on.
5 systems.
My company's transferring to. Referring to them as zones.
Yeah, zones.
For the first 11 years that I worked with the company, it was a system. Now it's starting to be zones. So a zone and a system, just to clarify, because I will slip back and forth, they're the exact same thing. You have 5 systems, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. What I consider, or what is considered a system, is 1 monitor board. We'll look at these because these are the easiest to associate. 1 monitor board, at least 1 sensor, which is what you have, or triggering device, which you don't have. So 1 monitor, 1 sensor, and at least 1 cannon, up to 10 cannons. So what you've got is West Baghouse, East Baghouse. Each of these are basically identical, 8 cannons and 8 cannons. And then you have zone 1, zone 2, and zone 3. Zone 1 is the ductwork system. At the end, the middle one is zone 2 or zone B, and the third one is zone C. I've got this one labeled A. This one's going to be labeled B and C. Labels here, and on the back panel of this one and of this one, D and E. We typically try to put the stickers on the back plate because it's neater looking. This one, there's no room on it, which is the reason that we're going to put them on the cover. Okay? Again, you can refer to these in whatever number, alphanumeric number, way you want to, but when you communicate with us, I'm gonna say which is zone A, which is zone B, or what system are you working on, okay? How many people we got? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Are all of you gonna be certified as quarterly inspections? Okay, I'll start with 1 sheet. Who's first? Okay, print and sign, please. There's a pen there if you need it.
Here's gonna do it, or just a few of us?
Otherwise, I'll forget at the end, say thank you, and then have to chase you down.
Great.
So only the people on this sheet are going to be allowed to perform the quarterly inspection. You cannot do training on how to do the quarterly inspection to other people. How to turn the system on. How to turn it on, what's involved with it. Feel free to train whoever it is you want to, but the quarterly inspection specifically trained by IPD.
So Scott, who's doing quarterly inspections? For ease of location, I'm going to work on this system or be working with this system to use for training. Reason for that is there's a cannon on that system that's somewhere in here versus up on a lift work, which takes way too much time going up and down with one person at a time. So this one I can do more people. Ignore these for right now, or imagine that all three of these look like this one, all and only green lights on the monitor board and the power monitor, as we talked about. You've got the indicator LEDs across the top are all out, all of your green indicators for normal, system armed, system on, and unmuted condition for the alarms is all green, okay? That's gonna be what you want this whole wall to look like, is all green lights. To give you an idea of an audible alarm, you know, not real loud. That's what I'm saying. It's an option to mute those before you go out for a disarm or before you go out to do the quarterly inspection. Or if nobody's going to be here to be bothered by it, skip it. You only have to come back here. Well, I guess you wouldn't need necessarily to come back here. You would want to visually verify. Part of the quarterly inspection that's not listed as a sign-off is a visual inspection as you're doing it. It may be common sense to you that you're gonna do that anyway, but just visually look to make sure that your conduit's not hanging open with your wires stretched through, that type of thing. Nothing's damaged, anything like that. So, this is normal condition as you normally would see it. This is what the power supply looks like. You've got your battery backup, your relays across the bottom. Something unique about the triple monitor versus the singles is I said that there are three relays per system: fault, actuation, and battery. Well, the triple monitor only has one battery supply or one power supply. So there's only one battery relay for all three of these. So you've got three on the left side and then two and two. So the one battery's global, fault actuation for this, fault actuation, and fault actuation. Make sense? All right. Something that is easier to go over on a system like this, we were talking about what happens when your batteries drain down, or what happens if power is lost, or if the system goes into actuation. I'm going to mute these to start, but what you're going to get is this condition. You have all of your LEDs lit. You're gonna have dual alarms, one alarm for fault, one alarm for actuation, and your red actuation LED lit. The other thing you'll see is down below here, there's a yellow LED. Each system in this case has its own LED. These are only gonna have one because there's only one system associated or zone associated. All of this indicates actuation. The first thing you want to do if you see this condition is to not assume that your cannons have actuated, but assume that the system has gone into actuation lockout until further proof. Open up the door, and right next to the yellow LED is a small push button. Go ahead and push that button. That resets the system. The only time this button is energized is if that yellow LED is lit. So if you have a circuit fault or an air fault or something, don't open the door and try to reset it, because you can push this screw and get the same result. There's nothing going to it. After pushing that, if all of the faults clear like they did here, the system went into lockout for some type of a power issue more than likely. If after pushing that button, you have an air fault, a circuit fault, and a Mylar fault still present, that's a good indication that your cannons have probably actuated on that system. You have an air fault because your nitrogen tanks are all empty, a circuit fault because the capacitors being monitored are destroyed, and a Mylar fault because your Mylar has also been destroyed.
The only way to find when cannon has fired is to look at the LEDs on each cannon?
My surefire way
is to check the nitrogen in the nitrogen tanks. If you're at zero, that's because you have a hole that big and there's no nitrogen. If you have any type of pressure in there, you don't have a hole that big. And, you know, there's something unique about that cannon. But air circuit and Mylar, after reset, that's a good indication. If you just have an air circuit and Mylar fault, then there's other troubleshooting that needs to get done. Again, I've given you quite a bit of information today. I've told you about specifications for canister or for nitrogen tanks. I've given you specifications for sensors, configurations, all sorts of things. Do you remember all of it? If you do, wow. If you don't, that's normal. You know, a lot of information. What I'm hoping that you'll remember is that red thing on the side of your process is the cannon. The black box is the sensor. And that you disarm the system by following that procedure of mute the buttons, rotate the cannons, and turn the key off. Those types of things, the basics, are what I'm hoping for. Basically, it's to make my life easier. If you call me at 2 o'clock in the morning, are you a 24-hour shift or 24-hour plant? Okay, then it's not so bad. But if you call me for support and I say, go to the cannon and let me know what it says, and you say, what's the cannon? My job became a lot harder. So I want to make our communication a lot easier, because a lot of the times, particularly after normal business hours, I'm the one that gets contacted. So that's where we're at. Anytime you have any type of fault, feel free to contact IPD. Call the office first. I don't give out my cell phone number, because if one of you called me right now and I'm giving a training, I'm not gonna just a minute and take a phone call. It doesn't work that way. Call the IP office. There will be somebody there that's going to help you, or they will put you in touch with somebody that is available. So after hours, there's a voice prompt that gives a cell phone number that's mine. So you at that point will be put in touch with me. So any questions on what we've got here? I know we've gone over it, but this is what it looks like, not a black box with nothing lit up. All right. Then I don't have anything else that doesn't pertain to the quarterly inspection. Those of you that are not involved in the quarterly can certainly come over with me and take a look at the cannons, and you know, I can give you a bit more information if needed, but I think we did a pretty thorough job of going over the cannon that was in the conference room. So I'm going to go ahead and mute these alarms right now, because doing the quarterly inspection, particularly the disarm mechanism and the magnet test, does create a fault. The disarm mechanism creates an audible alarm for, 3 seconds before you turn it back on, and the magnet test is going to create a fault for, 15 to 20, 30 seconds at most per cannon. So I'll leave those muted right now so I don't bother anybody. Any questions on the difference between the triple monitor or these three systems versus the single? All right, good deal. All right.
As far as opening it, we don't even do that, right?
Correct. It just makes it easier for more people to see. Okay. Let me get down first. Everybody signed off?
Yep.
All right, thanks, guys. And I'll pull out a quarterly sheet. All right. So again, the way that I've got the systems labeled is starting from the very end, A, B, C, D, and E. The sensors all have the systems labeled on those, as well as in there. Okay? So, this is one of the 40-pound cannons, and basically all of them you can see are, at least from right here, are 40-pound. They're quite a bit longer than the 20s. They look similar, The tank is going to be a bit bigger, but a 20 pound is only going to go to about like that. If you remove the electronics from the cannons, everything is exactly the same. The circuit boards, all of them are the same. The only difference is the size of the barrel slash canister and the size of the nitrogen tank. So this is a quarterly inspection sheet for system D. Let me just confirm. I'm sorry, for system E. And on the box, you can see number one. So this is the first cannon in the string of cannons. This one's pretty easy from, as we're looking at it left to right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The cannons 1, 2 to 7 are mounted right up on the top of here, just like this.
Is there the same amount of cannons in each zone, or is there a certain amount?
For this one and that one, they're both 8 cannons each, so 16 total between the two. Memory is correct. Zone 1 is 3 cannons, zone 2 is 1, and zone 3 is 2. So, yeah, these two are the same, everything else is different. Magnet, if you wouldn't mind holding that, and if you can not shine your flashlight on there for me. The side of the box opposite the conduit entrance, the reed switch is right here. So placing your magnet on top of the box, what I do is I put it down and move it over until I actuate the reed switch. You don't need to sneak up on it. I have some customers, I say, here, try it. And it's like, come on, I gotta go. Move it over, you got a big window, there's a dead spot, and then another window, but it's a pretty big range that it operates on. So, put the magnet down, and as you can see, I'm also activating a circuit fault. Reason for that? I'm taking off the charging and moving it to a discharge. Circuit fault indicates the charging is interrupted. So the red light stays on, the circuit light stays on, as long as the magnet's activating the reed switch. Once it's removed, it goes back on, and the green power light comes back on. As you probably saw, the yellow light comes on nice and bright, and then gets more and more dim. What I usually do is if this is in place, I'll put my hand over it and then operate it to cut off some of the ambient light. Now, with this design, it's probably obvious that we don't need to know down to the half a second how many seconds it takes. Number one, you seeing the yellow light go out is going to be different from you. Number two, your one Mississippi is different than his one alligator. So, we want to be as close as we can get, but it's not necessary to be within a half a second or a second of actual time. So, can all of you see the yellow light from there? This wiring's kind of coiled a little strange, but what I'll do, move it over. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. From here, with this condition and not covering it up so you can't see it, all I got was 8. When I did it earlier, with being able to shut off the light and operate it, I believe I saw 12 seconds on that sheet. So,
what's the range? 5
is the minimum. Okay. You should probably see, again, between 8 and a lot of them over there on the backside with those lights being out, I was 13, 14, 15 seconds in there. So, only to be able to possibly develop a trend. Now what you want to do is look at the center base of that LED, and that will give you that final little pinprick of light to see and monitor for. And Anybody want to try it? I can take that from you. There, if you want to rotate the disarm mechanism, if you can reach it, and then rotate it back. And I don't think I need to have you guys actually try doing the tank reading, right? Okay. Biggest thing is to remember to put the cap back on the Schrader valve. And use the right gauge, because I'm telling you, it is very startling.
Do we already have our shifting gauges?
Yes.
So, as far as the system, are there 8 cannons on this?
On this one there are, and on that one there
8
are.
8 per side.
Correct.
And how many sensors for these 8?
4. There's one there. There's one opposite, and there's 2 on top.
Okay, these are the primaries. Of course, there's 8 cannons.
Yep.
Are these the ones that are in the individuals? And the ones that are the ones that are the ones that are the ones that are
the I'm sorry? Yeah, it's right there, the black box on the.
Yeah, talking about your monitor.
Oh, yes, correct. Yep, yep, the single monitors. Yep.
The tri monitor is doing the ducting system. Or whatever,
you right, yep.
Enclosure with 3.
Correct.
Taking care of yep. Down there.
Single monitor enclosure, single monitor enclosure, all of that's triple.
Triple down there.
Yep.
Okay.
Any questions on that part? Okay. So on cannon D1, we've got 13 seconds. Yesterday I estimated it at 80. It might have been 75 or 78. I always just use 5-degree increments because, again, it's not critical. Battery load test I do with my meter on another section, but I can show you how to do that again. Tank pressure was 310 psi. It's slightly below the 325, but still within the minus 10%. Disarm mechanism test, we indicated yes on that one, and it is a 40-pound cannon. The isolation and the isolation up there are 40s, all across the top are the 20s. All right?
Going down 40 to 20.
Correct. And it's just repeat. All right? So like I said, I'd recommend that I get an email address from somebody. I can do it right from my phone out there, and I'll forward you on this sheet. Okay? I'll give you this sheet. Go ahead and type all that redundant crap in there, and you'd only have to do it one time. Thank you. So no more questions on that. What about the disarming of the system? Mute if necessary. Rotate, red light comes on, lock out if you want to or need to, and repeat, and then go back in and turn the key off.
So if you turn the key off, that really does kill power because even your power supply set alarm. When you turn the key off there, that's how you got your power supply to give you that yellow or green light.
You didn't have it, didn't you?
Oh, that was to create an actuation. That's a little... Yeah. Trick on how we create actuation. So turning it off does not give that. I'll show you again when we go
in
there.
Both. Yeah, kind of your
here, what we'll do hold that for me, please. Yeah, thanks. Rotate to off. Verify you've got your red light. Your lockout tagout goes in there if needed. Do that on all of them, and then that's okay. And are you guys done out here? Would you like any more information? Okay, very good. Then we'll go in here. Circuit fault lit, indicating that at least one of the disarms, and that's something to remember. An indicator here indicates that you at least have one of those faults, or you have at least one of those faults, I should say. This doesn't tell you if you have one cannon or more.
Yeah.
So you at least have one. So you've turned the disarms on all of them. You come back here, turn the key off. Again, if lockout's part of your deal, that's my lockout recommendation, not pulling the key. That key, that key, that key, that key, all of the keys on the cannons, they're all exactly the same.
I guess my thing is, if we're worried about the cannon, as far as the monitoring here, does that affect any of those, or because you're creating an alarm, those are going to be tripped anyways? In other words, it doesn't know the difference from a test or not, as far as your monitor is here.
No, the relay is going to change state. If any one of these or all of these are lit, it's going to change state. The only time the actuation relay changes state is when it's in what we call actuation lockout. I don't want to say when the system actuated, because that's misleading or inaccurate.
Okay.
When it's in actuation lockout, which can result from the system actuating.
Okay.
All right? So, right now...
Well, because I'm going to be writing an SOP, so...
Got it.
In other words, anytime any of this is done, you know, like you said, these alarms are going to happen, and people have to know that. There's no way of bypassing that.
Nope. As you can see, turning it off, we're not lit here. Nothing down here has changed other than only the fault relay has changed. Now the normally closed is open, and the normally open is closed. I guess there was some discussion on the correct way to label it. I don't know if that was involving any of you. I know that standard is shelf condition labeling. For some reason, the founder of our company labeled them the other way when they're energized. So,
well, he labeled it how I would read print. This is no real operation. In other words, if the relay is energized and those contacts are normal condition for not when it's sitting on a shelf, for when it's on the wall running.
Yep, exactly. So that's where we're at as far as this goes. Once you're done with everything, again, the sequence doesn't matter.
Okay.
Go ahead and rotate all of them first. If you do it that way, the efficiency-wise side of it is then you're only coming back here the one time. The downside of it, yours, these are fairly simple, but if you forget to do one, then you're going back and forth. So once you've rotated them all back, turn the key on and unmute the alarms. In that case, we still have the fault alarm. If you do see this, you need to go check again.
Right. Like you, go back out there, and like you have right now, one of them rotated.
Yep, exactly. Okay, any questions?
No.
Okay. There's your maintenance kit. If you do have any questions on our, they're on the door anywhere, they're not. At least on our quarterly inspections, we've got both office phone number and a global technician email. You send an email to this address, all of our service technicians in Minneapolis get a copy of it. So don't call me names, please, just be nice. All right, guys, again, if you have any questions, I can't stress it enough, no matter what it is.
Yeah.
No, they're for here. Those were locked up last night. I can't stress it enough. If you have questions, I recommend don't even start with the manual. Start with the phone and contact us. Maybe an air fault. You know, that's a pretty obvious one. But if you have an air fault, multiple times, then contact us and find out why. Those kind of things, that's a pretty simple one. But anything else, let us know. We'll point you directly down the right path. And I will try as hard as I can, because if I'm not scheduled to come here and you call me with a problem, nothing personal against you or the state of California, but I'd rather not come here unscheduled. I've got stuff that I want to do, where I am.
Minneapolis, a wonderful place to be.
It is. Well,
that's important.
It's not necessarily Minneapolis. My family lives there, so they're kind of cool, So don't hesitate to give us a call, all right? All right, I appreciate you.
On the process itself with multiple isolation cannons on all the inlets and outlets.
For explosion suppression cannons is a large dust collector, such as this cyclone and hanging bag unit. These cannons are employed to protect the dust separating and collecting portion. These cannons are used to block flame propagation into the environment. And these cannons are used to block flame propagation back into the process. Properly applied, these cannons provide complete explosion protection for applications of this type. IPD has conducted several explosion tests for its cannons using
So if you take a look at this, we've got 1 cubic foot of propane, and there is a rupture disc, but the suppression system is not turned on, so there is no suppression.
Typical process enclosures. Three examples follow. The voice you will hear is the voice of the test director.
3, 2, 1. Now we all know that propane is explosive, so this is impressive, but not necessarily informative. Next test, all of the variables are exactly the same, including the rupture disc. The only difference is that at the bottom, the explosion is suppressed, meaning the suppression system is turned on. And it's only triggered by the deflagration itself.
3, 2, 1.
And keep in mind, your process is sealed up much better than our little test vessel was back then. So all of that external spray would not be present. Now this one we use 6 pounds of cornstarch. When I first started, it was a bit more surprising to me. Again, a rupture panel and unsuppressed. Same cornstarch you've got in your cupboard at home or buy at the store. 1 pound of propane or 6 pounds of cornstarch? Which makes a bigger boom?
Wow. How did you ignite that? And was it airborne or how did you?
Yeah, it's like an injection. We would inject it. It was kind of neat. When I was involved in doing the testing, we'd go to the local grocery store with a shopping cart and basically kind of do one of these with the cornstarch into the basket. Again, same thing with a suppressed explosion, and it was bring your dog to work day for some reason.
3, 2, 1.
And there it goes. We were a little less formal back when we were first starting, not necessarily even started. Unsuppressed explosion, no rupture panel. Again, 6 pounds of cornstarch.
Allowing no venting in the explosion.
Yep. A little bit different environment.
2, 1, pull!
Yeah. So you had some wires going all the way to that thing, or how did you?
The wire was to trigger the ignition.
Right, so there must be some wire or something to
the thing. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Holy smokes.
Yep. So I don't know what do you know what the KST of your product is?
I think we're 78.
Okay, much lower than cornstarch, I believe, is right around 200.
Right.
Suppressed. Again, no this rupture panel. This explosion,
but does not trigger the extinguishing system.
And the cord being pulled, as he said, just ignites it. It does not trigger the suppression system. So.
That's very informative. Okay.
That's my final ending my presentation with a bang.
So in that case, that's old. Were we still using baking soda?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yep. And if I can get that flash drive back from you, please, I'd appreciate it. Yeah. Any questions before we move over to over to the equipment for the quarterly inspection and hands-on?
Nope.
Okay. Are one of you coming along to verify with your guys that it's okay to turn?
Yeah, John.
I guess if we
John,
turn
John and
one.
Them are back out there too.
Okay. I so guess if I can turn one on, I can turn any of them on.